Good morning, good afternoon, good evening, everyone. Wherever you sit in the world, we have participants registered from over the globe, which is showing how important this sustainability topic is for every one of us. So thank you for choosing this webinar, how oxy-fuel and hydrogen can contribute to decarbonization in energy-intensive industries. This webinar will consist of two presentations. First will be presented by myself. My name is Petr Tlamicha, and I'm heading what we call combustion segment in Air Products. And I will speak about oxy-fuel, features of oxy-fuel, and how this activity can contribute to carbon footprint reduction. Second part will be presented by my colleague, Martin Lorenz, who is a combustion development specialist, and he will talk more about hydrogen, property of hydrogen, hydrogen combustion, and some consideration of the fuel switch when you think about that. Before we start, I would like to cover a few housekeeping items. At the bottom of your screen are multiple application engagement tools you can use. All the engagement tools are resizable and movable, so feel free to move them around to get the most out of your desktop space. You can expand your slides area or maximize it to full screen by clicking on the arrows in the top right corner. If you have any questions during the webcast, you can submit them via the Q&A tool. We will try to answer all of them at the end of the webinar. If we will not be able to answer all, then we will for sure answer them by email later. In the resource tool, you can find today's slides and links to additional material and information. And this webinar will be recorded. So on-demand version of this webcast will be available approximately one day after the webcast and can be accessed using the same audience link that was sent to you already. I hope it helps, and we can start now. Let me first introduce very briefly Air Products. It's a global industrial gases and technologies provider. We are about a $10 billion company with more than 20,000 employees in 50 countries around the globe. We are more than eight decades in the business with many manufacturing and production facilities and big portfolio of customers in different segments. To visualize that better is the slide. We are an American company, but as you can see, more than half of the business is already outside of the United States. We have a big portion in Europe and also Asia. And as I said, the sustainability topic is very important for, I believe, all of us. So even Air Products has our own target, so we call it Third by 30. Our target is to reduce our own carbon footprint by 33% up to 2030, comparing the year 2015. By the way, by our products like carbon capture, hydrogen, etc., we are already helping our customers to reduce their carbon footprint today. And the volume we are helping to reduce is three times bigger than our own CO2 emissions. That's it about Air Products. So let's speak about the combustion. And because combustion technologies are heavily used in the industry for production of different materials, glass, iron and steel, ceramic, non-ferrous metals. And because we have participants from very different segments today, I will not speak about one specific application like aluminum melting or glass processing or whatever. Because regardless, the combustion is used for melting, drying, or heating, there are some common features which you can target to reduce your carbon footprint. Today, we have two main groups. of the combustion. Air fuel, where the fuel is combusted with air. It's quite conventional and many applications still use that. Or oxy-fuel already, which is well known for many years, but today market conditions is changing. And oxy-fuel has more space for application because of not only because of the feasibility, but also from economical point of view and fuel emission reduction. What is common on the combustion is CO2 emissions, because most of the combustion processes are using obviously natural gas or oil or coal, all simply saying based on the fossil fuels. They emit CO2, and CO2 is today the most discussed greenhouse gas emission component. So this picture is not surprising for, I believe, none of you. So we as a human, we are contributing to CO2 emission increase for many decades already. And I just pick up couple of segments which are big contributors, like iron, steel, cement, lime, non-ferrous metals, and glass and ceramic. You can see the percentage in the global emissions, CO2 global emissions. And despite of the fact, for example, for glass and ceramic, we see 2%, which might not be seen as a big number. But if you look on the real emission volume, it's enormous. And what we have today, we have Paris Agreement, we have Green Deal, we have Fit for 55, so simply saying we have legislation which giving us some guidance, but overall target is that we keep the global warming below 1.5°C. So legislation exists, we can discuss how good or how bad it is, but it's not the topic of today. But that's the main reason why many of the companies, I would say almost 100% of the company, had their own plan, roadmap, how to get the carbon neutrality to 2050 or different point in the time. But in Europe, we are looking at 2050 as the final year. And I'm trying to visualize that on this slide because today we have different options we can look at. Yeah? And as I said, I will not speak about any specific application, but those are, it's quite common for all. So we can look at the charge, we can look at the alternative materials, additives to the process, we can look at the furnace design, because new furnaces definitely contributed to process efficiency. I will speak about oxy-fuel today, like one of the option, then digitalization, waste heat recovery. And I believe those type of activities are first step. And the second and the final, maybe end game, if you like, will be to rid of the rest of the carbon you have in the emissions by electrification, carbon capture, or fuel switch. Regardless, it is hydrogen or ammonia or syngas, or simply saying low carbon fuel. Yeah, hydrogen is highlighted because it's the most promising and most discussed gas of the future, or fuel of the future. But I believe in first step, you can improve the efficiency up to 60% by just changing your process. And why? Because if you switch to hydrogen today, then obviously this switch will be very expensive. If you will do it after you improve the efficiency of your process to maximum, then obviously cost of this change will be reduced. So why oxy-fuel combustion? This I'm showing this conventional air fuel combustion, probably known for every one of you. I just pick up the methane, like a natural gas example. If you imagine you have process with 5 megawatt energy input, under these conditions of flue gas temperature 1000 degrees C, you will lose 2.6 megawatt through the chimney. Simply saying, available heat or efficiency of the process is less than 50%. The major contributor for that is obviously the nitrogen, which is not the item which is part of the combustion reaction. Nitrogen stays nitrogen, and what happened? It creates the flue gas volume, which is much bigger, and we are heating the nitrogen molecules, which taking the heat away from the process. Vice versa, oxy-fuel, if we eliminate the nitrogen, they're on the same furnace, same energy input, 5 megawatt, we will lose 1.2 by chimney, never zero, obviously. But available heat or process efficiency improve up to 75%, which is significant. Obviously, you can say here, okay, but today on the market, we have more efficient air fuel combustion because of recuperation or regeneration. Yeah, that's true. On the other hand, on oxy fuel, we can preheat oxygen, we can preheat natural gas, which is kind of waste heat recovery, if you like, or using the waste heat for this purpose. So we can improve efficiency of this oxy fuel combustion as well. And when we speak about oxy-fuel or oxygen, it's not only about the nitrogen elimination from the combustion process. There are more features which are improved. One of them is flame temperature, which definitely changing the efficiency of the process. On this chart on the left side, you can see 20% of oxygen as air fuel or 100% of oxygen as oxy-fuel. Everything in between we call enrichment. That means we are adding pure oxygen into combustion air up to certain level, because not for all application you can apply full oxy fuel combustion. When flame temperature improve, then obviously we improve also heat transfer. Yeah. And elimination of nitrogen, I spoke about it. The impact you can clearly see here on the flue gas volume. So once you start to add more oxygen into combustion air, up to full oxy fuel, you can reduce significantly flue gas volume, which is the part taking away the heat from the process. And it's again, not only this, we can look at the flame stability. In other words, if you look on the green line, this is air fuel combustion, and yellow triangle is showing flammable region of this mixture. So if you compare this green line with the line of the left side of the triangle, which is oxy fuel, where the flammable region is much wider, that means the flame is much more stable under different mixture. This is important for some of the processes. A good example is cement manufacturing or clinker manufacturing process, where the cement company is using different alternative fuels, and calorific value of those fuels are not stable. So a different mixture can still have stable flame because of oxygen. So simply saying, we are changing flame parameters. We have higher flame temperature. We have increased radiative heat transfer. We have more stable flame, reduced flue gas volume. We have improved available heat for the process. Consequently, it means specific energy consumption. So energy per ton of your product is going down. You can translate this directly to CO2 emissions if your fuel is based on fossil fuel. As I mentioned, enrichment or full oxy fuel combustion might not be perfect for all applications. We might consider just oxygen enrichment. And That's why we have a big portfolio of different applications for different type of industries. And all those applications or burners are developed in-house. We have our own R&D center where we are testing the technologies. And Air Products has more than 50 years experience already with oxy-fuel combustion. So what we do for our customers, if you hesitate, okay, makes sense for my process or not, we can look at it. Before we implement any technology, we do the first evaluation of the furnace, the process. We have very experienced R&D team, which is able to help with that. We can do CFD modeling to predict how your process will look like with oxy-fuel or enrichment. And that's the work on the feasibility. We can work also on economical side of it because of the oxygen pricing, oxygen equipment. And we can even test different type of burners in our R&D lab if you are afraid to use oxy-fuel directly in your process. So we can show and demonstrate the new type of the burners or even customer burner with the oxygen gas. So at this point, I will finish my part. And I hope I clearly explain how oxy-fuel works. And what I'm saying is, this is not the final solution for decarbonization, but it's a big contributor if you use this tool. And at this point, I will hand it over to Martin Lawrence, who is my colleague, and will explain more how hydrogen might be the final solution for decarbonization. So, Martin, over to you.
Thanks very much, Petr. Hello, everyone. I wanted to talk to you today about hydrogen and, as Petr said, how it could be a potential solution for eliminating CO2 emissions. So I wanted to start by introducing hydrogen itself. So hydrogen is the lightest and most abundant element in the universe. It's the first element on the periodic table. And a hydrogen atom consists of only one proton and one electron. So hydrogen makes up the majority of the mass of our sun and indeed most stars in the universe. And hydrogen molecules are made up of two hydrogen atoms. And probably most famously, hydrogen is used as rocket fuel. I think most people might be aware of NASA using the hydrogen for that. So just a little bit of an introduction there. However, on our planet, on Earth, hydrogen is not found on its own. It's always found as part of other compounds. And the most common sources of hydrogen are water and hydrocarbons. And typically, industrial hydrogen is used for fertilizer production, heat treatment of metals, and petroleum refining. So now on to the production of hydrogen. So there are two main production routes for hydrogen. There's steam methane reforming and electrolysis of water. So I'm going to start on the left with the reformation of the steam reformation of methane. And I've included the equation there for the reaction. And you can see that methane, which is the main constituent of natural gas, is reacted with water or steam at high temperatures to produce hydrogen and CO2. So I'd say about 99% of industrial hydrogen is made in that way at the moment. And as you can see, I've highlighted the CO2 there in the equation. And actually, this method of producing hydrogen is not very environmentally friendly. It produces quite a lot of CO2. It's actually in line with the amount of CO2 that's produced from combusting coal. So this method of producing hydrogen, we call the hydrogen that's produced grey hydrogen. And generally, it's not very good for reducing CO2, as I said. So what you can do is you can capture that CO2 from that process, and you can either store it or somehow use it. And if you capture enough of that CO2, then we can call that blue hydrogen, which is considered low carbon. And alternatively, you can make hydrogen from the electrolysis of water I've got on the right there. And again, I've shown the equation. So you add a current, electrical current, to water, and that splits it into its constituents, which is hydrogen and oxygen. And this process doesn't produce any CO2 directly, which obviously is good for sustainability. However, you do have to use renewable energy in order for it to be low carbon. And if you do it that way, then we call it green hydrogen. So either blue or green hydrogen are both low carbon and are suitable for fuel switching to reduce carbon dioxide emissions. So the next slide. I put together this diagram to show or give you an idea of how much carbon dioxide you can save by switching fuels. So on the left here, I've got the different colors of hydrogen. And on the right, I've got some common fossil fuels. If you take a look at the y-axis, it's the carbon dioxide emissions, which are usually expressed in grams of CO2 emitted per megajoule of the fuel. And if you look at the dashed horizontal green line, I've put that in there to denote the UK low carbon hydrogen standard, which is any hydrogen that is produced by emitting fewer than 20 grams of CO2 per megajoule will be considered low carbon. So you can see that the green and the blue hydrogen sit under that line, and any hydrogen producing anything more than the 20 grams of CO2 emitted per megajoule would be considered grey hydrogen. So the typical grey hydrogen steam reformation of methane process, if you was to capture the carbon of that and make it blue hydrogen, then you can save at least 78% of the CO2 emissions. And then I thought probably the most interesting fuel for everyone on the webinar today is natural gas. So if you was to switch from natural gas to low carbon hydrogen, then you can save at least 64% of your CO2 emissions. So next I wanted to talk about mode of supply, or how we could supply hydrogen to you. So obviously it depends on how much hydrogen you're going to need. And at the bottom there, I've got three different rows of different units, because I know that people work in different units. So we've got the volumetric flow rate in meters cubed per hour. We've got mass flow rate in kilograms per hour, and we've got power in megawatts. And I thought for most of the audience today, the power in megawatts would probably be the most useful to understand. So for the smaller applications, we can deliver hydrogen as compressed gas. And for the small to medium applications, we can deliver hydrogen as liquid, or we can generate it directly on your site. And these are the parts that I'm going to focus on the next couple of slides. And obviously, if you've got a much larger demand, then we can start to look at large plants, or if you happen to be in the vicinity of a hydrogen pipeline, then you might be able to take hydrogen from that. So hydrogen bulk delivery options then. So if we start on the left for the smaller applications, we have what we call maxi packs, and you can see them there in the picture on the left. So what they are is they're bundles of cylinders of hydrogen gas, and each bundle can hold up to 1.3 megawatt hours of hydrogen. And as you can see, they can be stacked to save space on site for storage. And the next level up, let's say, is the middle picture there, which is what we call tube trailers. So these are storing high pressure gaseous hydrogen. And depending on the pressure that you store them at, each trailer can hold between 16 and 58 megawatt hours. And then finally on the right there, you've got liquid supply. So we can also supply hydrogen as a cryogenic liquid. And each trailer can carry up to 140 megawatt hours of hydrogen. And what you would need on your site is you'd need a cryogenic storage tank, which Air Products could supply, along with some vaporizers, which would allow you to use hydrogen as a gas at the end use point. In terms of